Ông quay cho. Ông nhập đẹp bằng to cái nhầm ca này tệ vị thị xạm nạ ca. Này, chia bằng to này cứ ông nhập đẹp sạch đập nơi xâm nào xông rồi bỏ. Cảm ơn các bạn đã theo dõi và hãy subscribe cho kênh Ghiền Mì Gõ để không bỏ lỡ những video hấp dẫn. Hãy subscribe cho kênh Ghiền Mì Gõ để không bỏ lỡ những video hấp dẫn. Hãy subscribe cho kênh Ghiền Mì Gõ để không bỏ lỡ những video hấp dẫn. Hãy subscribe cho kênh Ghiền Mì Gõ để không bỏ lỡ những video hấp dẫn. Hãy subscribe cho kênh Ghiền Mì Gõ để không bỏ lỡ những video hấp dẫn. Hãy subscribe cho kênh Ghiền Mì Gõ để không bỏ lỡ những còn tại đây sao panh hà pivili đây sao nơi đây xíu ni ông nhầm rẻ miền bầm non bên chóp nơi đã bị rẻ nơi panh hà thằng lái đây dừng lương một vừa cách vừa phía xa nơi khăn ông đầm nà ca sạm nà ca mùi sao bà đà ni rồi sân bờ chia ca bình dịp pil từ đó ngày chắn có đôi chân mình đầm nâu đây vì vừa bị rẻ nơi tại mùi tiết ti được nên xong phía kỳ đại phía phòn nâng bánh hát tăng ốc xong cũng hát nơi phía bà lìa đại bài chạy ai hay một số mình cứ kháng cổng mê tư bì cả phía kỳ đầy nôn chia miền bầm nông xong nào xong bị đọc tới đọc ràm nền tì hoặc nhìn xong bà côl bê tư kà tư cổng mê tư bì cả phía kỳ đầy lúc nôn chia đầm bầy miền ọc cá nâng nông ca lạng thư xong nào xong hay กรมธุรกิจการเพื่อได้เมียนเปเปเลียเตปรมาดับรามในตีบนอก
Thank you very much,
Your Honour. Chiran Lo Pien.
Am I wrong to assume that there are two topics left today to discuss? First of all, the one I would like to raise now, which is related to Deutsch's testimony in the afternoon.Or during the afternoons of the next week's sessions. And the second topic would be the hearing of Ben Kiernan via video link. I assume that that's going to be discussed this afternoon. Am I correct? Okay, I understand my assumption is correct. Well, then I will briefly say a few words about the somewhat alarming suggestion which was made, I believe, 2 days ago that Doig will be heard next week in the afternoon. First of all, just to make it clear, Doig is an important witness to our client. He's one of the very few, if not the only one, who may be able to give evidence, direct evidence, incriminating our client. We wish to emphasize that he has very little to say, as far as we understand, which is relevant for the first mini-trial. The scope of the first mini-trial is limited, and it certainly doesn't cover S21, the internal purges of the Communist Party, which took place after 1975. He knows very little, as far as I'm aware, very little of the evacuation of Phnom Penh. I understand he was not here in April 1975, and he can say very little about the subsequent movement of the population in 1975-1976. At best, he can offer hearsay evidence, which in addition may be tainted by torture. Well, having said that, he remains an important witness. And that leads to the inevitable question, what will happen when Your Honours decide to hear him or start hearing him on Monday afternoon? As you know, our client has so far always waived his right to be present in the afternoon, and we continued without him hearing witnesses. But this witness is different, and we cannot exclude the possibility, there is a serious possibility that he will want to be present when Doig testifies and that he will not waive his right to be present. And I assume that I do not have to explain to your honours that Nguyen Chia has that right to be present when Doig is being questioned, and he has the right to confront, directly confront witnesses, certainly witnesses which are of some importance, like Doig. I can refer to the internal rules, Rule 81, the establishment law of this institution, the various international human rights instruments, CCPR, Article 40, the Cambodian Criminal Code, Article 297, they all contain this basic right that an accused has to confront a witness in person. And this right would be violated, this right to confront a witness, to challenge the testimony, that would be violated if Your Honours next Monday decide to hear Doig while our client is unable to attend, or better, actively participate in these proceedings. The famous or infamous holding cells are not the magical solution. I would like to stress that. And my colleague Michael Karnovas said a little bit about this yesterday. And in addition to that, I would like to say that there are basically three reasons why the holding cell established by this court downstairs are not a solution to the problems I just mentioned. Although there is the possibility to follow the trial via video link, which I used to call tele, downstairs, that does not necessarily mean that my client is effectively participating. If you look at, one looks at Rule 81, Section 5, one sees, first of all, the client's consent or the accused's consent is a necessary condition for continuing with the hearing while the accused is in the holding cell. As I said, there's a serious possibility that my client will not give that permission. And then, another reason why the holding cell is not the solution is that there is no substantial delay, at least not yet. Nguyen Chia's wishes to be present in court can be easily accommodated by changing the schedule and moving Doig to the morning, where my client is generally able to actively participate in the proceedings, and less important witnesses can be heard in the afternoon, as had been the case so far. If other witnesses are heard, less important witnesses are heard, our client intends to continue waiving his right to be present. And third, importantly, even in the holding cell, or I should say, especially in the holding cell, our client will not be able to actively participate in these proceedings. And that's a requirement of Rule 81.5. Nguyen Chia is transferred to the holding cell not because he wants or intends to follow the proceedings from downstairs. My client is transferred to the holding cell every time he goes there because he's no longer able to do so. Whether here or downstairs, but my client is not feeling well, he cannot participate effectively in these proceedings. You may remember that in the beginning, some weeks ago, we would inform the court about our client's condition, and we told you several times that our client had fallen asleep downstairs. I can assure you that is what usually happens when he goes to the holding cell. Asleep, I don't have to explain. He is no longer actively participating in those procedures. We stopped informing Your Honours about this, about our client's condition downstairs, but you must believe me when I say that you can safely assume that as a rule, our client's mental or health condition when downstairs is such that he can no longer meaningfully participate in these hearings, whether that is a television or a video link or not, whether he's able to call us on the telephone or not. There's one important decision which deals with this very specific topic, and that is the decision of the appeals chamber of the ICTY in Stanisic. If Your Honours like, I can provide you later with the details of this decision, but it's a decision which was rendered on the 16th of May 2008, and it dealt exactly with this issue. The trial chamber in that case had established a video link with the detention centre where Stanisic was able to follow the proceedings which are taking place in a different location. The appeals chamber annulled the decision of the trial chamber and said that the trial chamber had revised that decision for three important reasons. First of all, the trial chamber had not given Stanisic's right, the accused's right, to be present at trial sufficient weight. They hadn't taken that sufficiently into consideration. Also, the appeals chamber said that the trial chamber should have looked for reasonable alternatives to the video link. And they said they should have postponed the beginning of the trial for an additional 3 to 6 months in order to allow Stanisic to recover and to see whether he was able to come to court after that particular period. This 3 to 6 months period was not considered a substantial disruption of the proceedings by the appeals chamber. And finally, the appeals chamber ruled, and we claim that is important as well, and that's something that you should do as well, that the trial chamber should have investigated whether the accused, Stanisic, was actually able to effectively participate from the detention unit when he was physically or mentally unwell. That fact suggested that he was also unable to participate while in the detention centre. And the trial chamber should have investigated that. And that is something that we want you to do as well. To conclude, there is a serious risk that our client Munchia will not be able to be in court in the afternoon next week and the weeks after that. He's unfit to follow the procedures in court, especially when being interrogated in the morning, as is your intention. That is a very exhausting experience for our client. And my request is simple. Take this into consideration when you make the schedule for next week and the weeks after that. And our suggestion is, I'm sure there are other solutions to this particular problem, but our suggestion would be that we simply start with DOIC in the morning and then we finish hearing DOIC as a witness, and that we then hear our client so that he can fully exercise his rights to be present at trial and to confront this particular witness. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. President. I will try to be fairly brief here. First, I believe I just heard counsel suggest that it was only a few days ago that he became aware DOIC was going to testify next week. If that's what he asserted, that is, of course, incorrect. a schedule was announced around the time of the last break, 3 weeks ago, some 3 weeks ago, explaining the intent to hear the accused in the morning and witnesses in the afternoon, starting with Deutsch. I'm not sure why counsel felt the need to make assertions about Deutsch's relevant testimony to this case. Suffice it to say that this is a witness that will have relevant things regarding historical background, and most importantly, to the upcoming segment of this trial, which the accused and the counsel continue to ignore in their comments, which is how the regime was structured. What were the organizations? What authority did different organizations have? And how did the communications and reporting work? So there are many issues that Deutsch will be able to testify to. But those are all not directly in the issue that is before you right now, which is the assertion that some right of the accused would be violated by hearing Deutsch in the afternoon. And there's, of course, no question here about the accused's right. They do have the right to participate in the trial. They have the right to confront witnesses. But the defense have gotten ahead of themselves here. The issue is whether Nguyen Che is fit to participate in this trial in the morning and afternoon. And we had extensive hearings on this issue last year. The court asked an expert to conduct examinations who found that Nguyen Che was fit. There has been nothing that has happened. There is no medical evidence to establish that Nguyen Che is unfit to participate in these proceedings. In fact, to the contrary, it is very clear from what has happened in this trial to date that he is fit and able to participate. I note that certainly it is a good thing that the option has been made available to the accused to go down to the holding cell and participate there if they choose, and if they choose to follow that procedure. We think that is a good procedure. But that is not the same thing as a determination that the accused are unfit to participate in these proceedings. Nguyen Che is fit. There have been extensive hearings. And there is no medical evidence or other reason to believe that he is not able to continue participating in these proceedings. In fact, the trial chamber will undoubtedly remember that there have been a number of days where the accused has participated in court in both the morning and afternoon. One occasion testifying in both the morning and afternoon. In another occasion, testifying in the morning and being present in the afternoon for hearings of witnesses, and even questioning one of the witnesses, Long Nguyen himself. So there is simply no reason for the court at this point to make a determination, or there is no basis for the court to determine at this point that Nguyen Che is unfit to participate in the afternoon. We may get, if things change, our position here is that we proceed, and unless and until we arrive at a situation where an accused is too sick to participate and a medical doctor certifies that, then we will deal with that if we arrive at that point. But it would be very disruptive to the schedule of this court for everyone to have been planning and preparing for next week's proceedings to be Nguyen Che in the morning and Deutsch in the afternoon, for now to suddenly change that schedule. And unless and until we arrive at a point where an accused is unable to participate in the proceedings, and that is certified by a medical doctor, this is not an issue that we need, that we should be making last-minute changes to the schedule upon. So our suggestion is that we proceed as planned, And the accused, certainly, we have doctors around here. If we reach that point, we will deal with it. And in terms of the holding cells, that is an option for the accused. If Nguyen Chea wishes to participate in this courtroom, he has that right to do so. If he wishes to participate in the holding cell, there is a procedure for him to do it that way if he is more comfortable in the afternoons. But that is their choice, and is subject, of course, to the waivers and procedure. But let's not confuse the issue here. Nguyen Chea does have the right. Nobody is stopping Nguyen Chea from being present in this courtroom while Doik is here. And until a medical doctor certifies that he's unable to do so, we should proceed as planned. Thank you.
If I may very briefly.
មេធាវីនៅមុខបានស្ដាប់នៅការលើកឡើងរបស់មេធាវីរបស់ក្រុមការពារលោកនួនជាហើយនឹងបានស្ដាប់នៅអ្វីដែលជាការលើកឡើងរបស់សហប្រជាជាតិយើងខ្ញុំយល់ថាយើងខ្ញុំគ្រប់គ្រងនៅអ្វីដែលខាងសហប្រជាជាតិបានលើកឡើងថាជាការសមហេតុផលដោយសារថា ករណីលោកលួនជាត្រូវបានការកសោបចាតាមលក្ខណៈវិជ្ជាសាស្ត្របញ្ជាក់ថាគាត់មានសមត្ថភាពនៅក្នុងការចូលរួមគ្រប់គ្រងរួចហើយហើយម្យ៉ាងទៀតការមានគាត់មានសិទ្ធិនៅក្នុងការជួលសវនកម្មនៅក្នុងបន្ទប់ខាងក្រោមដែលជាវិធីមួយដែលមានអនុញ្ញាតដោយវិធានទេក្នុងហើយម្យ៉ាងទៀតក៏មានទូរស័ព្ទសម្រាប់ទំនាក់ទំនងនៅក្នុងករណីដែលគាត់ ត្រូវការតាក់ទងមកមេធាវីរបស់គាត់អាចមានសិទ្ធិនៅក្នុងការទំនាក់ទំនងមកមេធាវីរបស់គាត់ដើម្បីសួរឆ្លើយទៅលើលោកដូចថែមទៀតផងដូច្នេះគាត់នៅតែមានសិទ្ធិនៅក្នុងការចូលរួមនៅក្នុងសវនកម្មដែលគ្រាន់តែគាត់មានសិទ្ធិគាត់អាចចូលរួមពីបន្ទប់ខាងក្រោមតែប៉ុណ្ណោះហើយម្យ៉ាងទៀតប្រសិនបើករណីដែលថាគាត់បានចូលរួមពីព្រឹកហើយនៅពេលល្ងាច គាត់លើកថាគាត់មិនមានសុខភាពគ្រប់គ្រាន់ឬក៏មិនមានលទ្ធភាពនៅក្នុងការពិចារណានៅក្នុងការប្រមូលអារម្មណ៍ដើម្បីតាមដានសក្ខីកម្មពេលល្ងាចឲ្យបានគ្រប់គ្រាន់ទេសម្រាប់ករណីសវនកម្មពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងដូចនេះដែលជាសាក្សីមួយរូបចុះសម្រាប់ករណីផ្សេងៗទៀតថាតើគាត់នឹងត្រូវប្រើសិទ្ធិបើតុលាការអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យគាត់ពេលល្ងាច គាត់ត្រូវតែមានសវនកម្មតែកន្លះថ្ងៃដូចគ្នាដែលគាត់ចូលតម្រូវឲ្យស្ដាប់នោះគឺសម្រាប់សាក់សីផ្សេងៗទៀតគាត់នឹងទៀមទាសិទ្ធថាគាត់សុំឲ្យមានសវនកម្មតែកន្លះថ្ងៃអញ្ចឹងវានឹងធ្វើឲ្យសវនកម្មនេះនឹងពិបាកដូច្នេះខាងមេធាវីដើមដំណរដ្ឋវិញ្ញាណស្នើសុំថាតុលាការបន្តនីតិវិធីដូចដែលតាមព្រៀងទុកបាទសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធាន
Thank you. I'm sorry I jumped up after the prosecution finished. I forgot about the existence of the civil parties for a moment. Just to be absolutely clear, we are not asking this court to declare our client unfit to stand trial. We don't take that position. What we are asking you is to take into consideration that there is a serious possibility that in the afternoon our client will not be mentally able to continue actively participating in the procedure in the examination of an important witness. All we are trying to do here is give you an advance warning. What we want to avoid is unnecessary delays in the schedule. If you stick to this schedule, the original intention is that sooner or later, whether a doctor is consulted or not, we will have to adjourn the hearing because our client will probably not waive his right to be present. We will not give the usual letter showing that our client does not object to you continue without him being present.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
Thank you, Mr. President, and Your Honors, for allowing me this brief opportunity to also weigh in on this matter. By practice, during the opening statements and then just a few days ago, when we had indicated that Mr. Inkstree was incapable of being here and was willing to waive his presence, the trial chamber indicated that this was a significant segment of the proceedings and therefore had to be present. So the trial chamber, by its own decisions, have in a sense recognized that there are instances and there are differences between being physically in court and being in the holding cell where one can participate. I couldn't help but think back of the opening statements and the height of hypocrisy today for the prosecution to stand up and say, well, they can participate down there, yet Mr. Cayley had indicated how in God's name, I think that was the quote, how in God's name can he take instructions from his client if he's down there? He has to be in court. So in opening statements, the prosecution is saying, have to be here. The civil parties were saying they have to be here. We were saying he's physically unfit. He's willing to waive the presence. So there is some sort of hypocrisy here. Now, let me just go back to some jurisprudence that has already been before the trial chamber in different contexts, but nonetheless deal with this issue. It is very clear that being physically present is not the same as being mentally present. Physically present is not the same as mental presence. So you can have an accused here, but if they aren't able to mentally follow along, either because they're in pain or because simply they're fatigued, then it is not the same. And in fact, we have cited in the past a German case or a case that came from the European Commission on Human Rights. It's the Milky versus Germany. Which was ruled, it's HR 30047/96, dated 25 November 1996. We've also have cited for you in the past Prosecutor versus Strugar from the ICTY, IT-01-42-T. Decision read the defense motion to terminate proceedings, 26 May 2004. And of course, there is the Stanford versus UK, United Kingdom, that's European Court of Human Rights, 16757/90, 23 February 1994. And I should note that in the past, this particular tribunal, and this is jurisprudence that it was actually invoked by none other than Judge Lamont when we were moving to recuse him, has referred to, made reference, and used jurisprudence of the European Court on Human Rights. So I'm citing authority that has already been accepted and used by all parties, the prosecution, the defense, including Judge Lamont when he hired a British barrister to defend him, Mr. Emerson. In Strugar, the court indicated, held that the requirement of presence in proceedings, quote, appears to be to ensure the presence of an accused person who is capable of assisting the tribunal in the presentation of his or her defense. According to the Human Rights Committee, fair trial rights, quote, are not respected where the accused is unable to properly instruct his legal representatives. Now, the prosecution says, well, there is no evidence. Well, first of all, the prosecution misdirects the trial chamber because there was never a submission that Mr. Nunchia is unfit, quote, unquote. The submission is that due to his age, if he were to testify in the morning, he is so fatigued in the afternoon that he cannot assist, whether he is in court here or in the holding cell. In the Stanisic case, Stanisic, who is being tried at the moment, he was the head of the intelligence services for Yugoslavia and for Serbia, had physical problems, medical problems, that is. They tried to get around that by placing a video link from his holding cell. And there, the jurisprudence was such that that is insufficient. If there wasn't a distinction, Your Honors, between being in court and being down in the holding cell, why, I ask rhetorically, then are the accused required to sign a waiver? It is one thing to sign a waiver, and so the person can go, the accused can go back to his actual cell, his cell where there is nothing. If indeed there is no difference, then, first of all, none of the accused should have to be forced to be here, irrespective of the importance of the proceedings. And secondly, they should be able to come and go as they wish, without having to furnish explanations of health, and then to actually waive. The waiver means that they're not... they're willing to allow the proceedings to continue in their absence, whether they're able to follow or not. They're willing to allow the proceedings to continue. That's the essence of the waiver. But it is a fundamental right, and a right that cannot be qualified to suggest that you can waive. You can waive this right to participate in court. It is insufficient to say they can be down in the holding cell when they don't want to be in the holding cell. They want to be here. They want to be fresh. They want to be able to look and observe the witness. They want the witness to be looking at them or to have the ability. And in this instance, and this may occur in other instances, the accused is insisting on being present. To put the witness through the paces of an examination, to exhaust him in a sense, and then say, and now we're either going to force you to be here, whether you like it or not, or you can go down there where you're going to be asleep, and this way, somehow, we're affording you your rights. I submit, Your Honors, is a charade. I submit that this would be a disservice to this institution and to the legacy of this particular institution. What has been proposed, and I'll admit that perhaps it could have been proffered slightly earlier, but what has been proposed is that there are alternatives that effectively would guard against any delays and will protect everyone's interests, whether it be the civil parties, the prosecution, or the rights of the accused. Doug can testify morning and afternoon. Nunchia has not said, well, I can't listen to it in the afternoon. It may come to the point where that is the case as well. It is his right to say that. And so, but until that point, Nunchia is not saying, I'm not competent. Find an excuse to delay, to obstruct. What he is saying is, give me the opportunity to have the presence of mind so I can follow the proceedings, so I can give you instructions, so at some point I will be able to be of some meaningful use to you. If Nunchia is sleeping in the afternoon while Doik is giving testimony, unless he's provided with Khmer translations of the transcripts and given the opportunity to go through those transcripts and absorb those transcripts, how has he participated? Better yet, how is he able to instruct his client on details by the very same admissions by the prosecution of all the information that Doik has, because he's a very important
លោកថាការពេលវេលាប្រហែលទៀតឡើយនេះពលោកនិយាយពីដងហើយតែមិញលោកនិយាយម្ដងហើយឥឡូវនេះអង្គជំនះអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យលោកនិយាយម្ដងទៀតប៉ុន្តែអង្គជំនះបានជម្រាបហើយអគួរសន្សំសម្តាយពេលវេលាដែលសារយើងមានពិធីបត់ 2 ទៀតដែលត្រូវតែចែកគ្នាក្នុងវិភាគីមានរហូតដល់1ម៉ោងកន្លះបើមិនដល់ពេលរសៀលបីម៉ោងអាចត្រូវបានពន្យាពេលរហូតដល់ម៉ោង5ឬក៏ម៉ោង6ក៏ដោយ
The prosecution admits that Doik is an important witness. I was confused also at the beginning, some of the remarks by my learned colleague on this end regarding Doik, but the prosecution has indicated that he is a vital witness. And yes, to the, is the answer to the civil parties. If there are critical witnesses and where the accused feel that they need to be present in the courtroom to assist their defense, it is their right. This case is not just about the civil parties and the victims. It's not just for the prosecution. This also is about those who are being tried. They have rights. You, Your Honors, are, of course, have to run this case, but you do so in taking into consideration everyone's rights. And in doing so, we submit that what has been proposed by the defense of Nunchia is an appropriate and reasonable measure. It will not delay. If we follow what the prosecution is suggesting, we will come across delays almost from Monday. And so I think this is one instance, Your Honor, where we need to be somewhat flexible. And in the future, perhaps parties should inform the trial chamber in advance, well in advance, when these sort of situations, so that the trial chamber can accommodate by making sure that there are available witnesses to fill in the gaps. I apologize for taking longer. But I appreciate the opportunity to be heard. Thank you very, very much, Mr. President and Your Honors.
បាទអរគុណហើយសូមសាប្រិញ្ញាខ្លីបានហើយពីព្រោះអង្គជំរះបានក្តាប់ស្ដាប់ព័ត៌មាននឹងដូចជាសពគ្រប់សំលមមនឹងអាចយកទៅពិចារណាថ្លឹងថ្លែងក្នុងការរៀបចំនៅលើ
Thank you, Mr. President. I will be extremely brief. I'm not sure whether counsel didn't understand my statement or just have chosen to ignore our position, but let it be clear, this decision needs to be based on evidence from a doctor. Counsel likes to complain about people testifying, lawyers testifying in the court. is the evidence going to be upon which this decision is going to be based, the assertions of counsel that Mr. Nguyen Che is asleep and unable to participate in the afternoon when medical doctors have made contrary determinations. And I would simply refer back to the last medical report, which is document E62/3/13. By Professor Campbell, in which he notes that Nguyen Che had scored 30 out of 30 on a mini mental state examination, which I believe he testified was equivalent to the capacity of a 25-year-old. It is very clear from these proceedings so far that Nguyen Che's mental condition remains almost razor sharp. And until there is medical evidence for reason for us to have a basis to determine that he is unable to participate in the afternoons, this is a premature issue. That is simply our position.
Thank you, President. The trial chamber has just deliberated briefly on some alternative proposals and wishes to ask for the relevant parties' immediate reaction, please. The first is this. Although it is the procedure that an accused is questioned first, the trial chamber wishes to hear the reaction of particularly Nguyen Chia's defence to the suggestion that we hear the testimony of Doik morning and afternoon until it is concluded before the accused Nguyen Chia is questioned. The second matter that we wish to seek immediate reaction on is whether it would assist if during the course of Nguyen Chia's testimony he was entitled to ask for more short breaks to allow him to rest. Now, I'm not suggesting, or the trial chamber is not suggesting that we change the usual procedures of morning, lunch and afternoon adjournments, but as the need arises, if counsel would wish to ask for more breaks. So those are two matters. They're not necessarily associated, but they're two matters that the President seeks your immediate reaction to. First, Counsel for Nguyen Chia.
Thank you very much. The first question was whether it would help to start with Doik in the morning and the afternoon. I think the answer is yes, it will. It's much less tiring for my client to sit and listen and to behind me and sit there and answer questions. Although I cannot guarantee that it will last the entire day. Of course. So, but it will definitely help. It will be a big step forward. The second question I would have to discuss with my client, I can do that during the afternoon break. I can inform the trial chamber as soon as we resume this afternoon. I don't know whether that will be a solution to the problem.
Well, we don't want lengthy submissions on this topic. It is a practical suggestion. So no more than 1 minute, yes or no, in the afternoon, please. And indeed, you probably don't even need to respond to it, because the trial chamber has indicated that it would be prepared to consider such applications. They would have to be with some basis, of course, made with some basis. Does Yang Sari's defence team wish to comment?
Your Honour, you indicated relevance, so that's why.
suffice it to say, I'm in agreement with what the team has indicated.
Thank you, Your Honour. Our position would be that certainly the alternative you've suggested, which is Doik testifying in the morning and afternoon continually, certainly preferable to the what was proposed by the Nguyen Chia team, which was to have Doik in the morning and then switch to other witnesses. So if the trial chamber is going to choose between those two options, we certainly would prefer the proposal that Doik testify morning and afternoons.
Thank you.
បាទអរគុណឥឡូវនេះយើងមានព័ត៌មានសំឡំមហើយលើបញ្ហានៃការរៀបចំកាលវិភាគសម្រាប់វិភាគសាដេញដោលសម្រាប់សប្តាហ៍ក្រោយដោយមានការបត់បែនដើម្បីធ្វើយ៉ាងណាឲ្យកិច្ចដំណើរការប្រព្រឹត្តទៅបានហើយជាកិច្ចបន្តគឺរបៀបវរៈមួយទៀតដែលមាន2គឺដោយបញ្ហានេះគឺជាប់គ្នាទី1គឺសំណើសុំរបស់សហប្រញ្ញាសូមឲ្យស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មអ្នកជំនាញឈ្មោះប៊ិនខេនិនតាមរយៈប្រព័ន្ធសោតទស្សន៍នៅក្នុងអំឡុងពេលសកម្មភាពខាងមុខនិងមួយទៀតគឺការជំទាស់របស់ក្រុមវិទ្យាការពីក្តីក្នុងការស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មសំណើសុំរបស់ក្រុមវិទ្យាការពីក្តីលោកអៀងសេរីស្នើសុំយកឯកសារបន្ថែមពីអ្នកជំនាញតែជាមុនពេលអ្នកជំនាញផ្ដល់សក្ខីកម្មនេះជាបញ្ហាដែលត្រូវតែជជែកពិភាក្សាហើយរួមគ្នាតែម្ដងយើងមិនបាច់បបែកចេញពីគ្នាទីដោយធ្វើដាច់ពីគ្នារវាងសំណើសុំរបស់សហប្រញ្ញាហើយនឹងមួយទៀតគឺសំណើសុំរបស់លោកអៀងសេរីដោយនៅក្នុងដំណាក់កាលដំបូងនេះគឺអង្គជំនះបុគ្គលវេទិកាជូនទៅក្រុមសហប្រញ្ញាដើម្បីលើកឡើងអំពីបញ្ហានេះហើយលើកឡើងអំពីការជំទាស់ទៅនឹងសំណើសុំរបស់ក្រុមវិទ្យាការពីក្តីស្នើសុំយកឯកសារបន្ថែមពីអ្នកជំនាញជាមុនអ្នកជំនាញផ្ដល់ទៅខេកម្មហើយបន្ទឹមនេះក៏មានទៅពេលវេលាសម្រាប់ដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋបាលនេះផងដែរដែលភាគីទាំងពីរមានរយៈពេល90នាទីហើយពេលវេលាអាស្រ័យលើភាគីទាំងពីរបែងចែកអង្គមុននឹងបកគលវេទិកាអង្គជំនះសួរទៅតំណាងសហប្រញ្ញាថាតើបានបែងចែកពេលវេលាគ្នាហើយនៅរវាងតំណាងសហប្រញ្ញាជាមួយនឹងមេធាវីនាំមុខតំណាងដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋរំនីអំពីប្រធានបទទាំងពីរនេះ
បាទសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានជាបឋមសូមគោរពលោកប្រធានសូមគោរពអង្គជំនះសូមគោរពអង្គសំណាកាទាំងមូលនៅពេលនេះខ្ញុំសូមអនុញ្ញាតលើកឡើងទាក់ទងនឹងការយល់ឃើញរបស់សហប្រញ្ញាចំពោះការប្រើប្រាស់បច្ចេកវិទ្យាសោតទស្សន៍ក្នុងការស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មរបស់អ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរហស្សនាម TC 100 TC 38
ការបែងចែកពេលវេលាយ៉ាងម៉េចទៅលើឲ្យ90នាទីណាឬបតិចជាងនឹងល្អហើយណាពីព្រោះឥឡូវពេលវេលាគឺពេលនេះរហូតដល់រសៀលនេះយើងមានបំណងបញ្ចប់នៅបញ្ហាការតិចវិភាសានៅក្នុងបញ្ហាទាំងឡាយដែលបានកំណត់សម្រាប់ធ្វើសកម្មភាពនេះ
ខាងសហប្រញ្ញាលោកវិធានមានពេល60នាទីហើយជូនខាងសហមេធាវីនាំមុខចំនួន40នាទីបាទ
សូមអញ្ជើញហើយអង្គជំនះនឹងអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យលោកបន្តត្រឹមម៉ោង12:15 នាទី
បាទខ្ញុំសូមអនុញ្ញាតលើកឡើងតទៅទៅនឹងការយកឃើញរបស់សហប្រញ្ញាចំពោះការប្រើប្រាស់បច្ចេកវិទ្យាសោតទស្សន៍ក្នុងការស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មរបស់អ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE 38ដោយលោកស្រីជាក្រុមជៀបសាប់ហើយនៅក្នុងអនុសារណៈចុះថ្ងៃទី2ខែមីនាឆ្នាំ2012យកឯកសារលេខ E172/5ត្រង់កថាខណ្ឌ6លោកប្រធានអង្គជំនះបានបង្គាប់ថាភីគីអាចដាក់អំណាចអំណាងដល់ផ្ទាល់មាត់បានពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងការប្រើប្រាស់បច្ចេកវិទ្យាសោតទស្សន៍ក្នុងការស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មរបស់អ្នកជំនាញដែលកោះហៅដោយអង្គជំនះសាលដំបងដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE 38និងដើម្បីឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងការជំទាស់ដែលមានលើកឡើងដោយមេធាវីការពីក្តីរួមជាមួយសហសេវករបស់ខ្ញុំគឺលោកវ៉ាងសង់ភីគីសហប្រញ្ញាមានយោបល់ប្រហែលជា60នាទីយ៉ាងច្រើនហើយទុកពេលសប្តាហ៍នេះគឺទុកជូនថាមេធាវីនាំមុខចំនួន30នាទីដើម្បីលើកឡើងពីការយកឃើញរបស់ខ្លួនលោកសិចក្រមតាប់តាំងពីពេលចាប់ដើមមកវាជាការសំខាន់ណាស់ក្នុងការបញ្ជាក់ជាថ្មីឡើងវិញនៅមូលដ្ឋានច្បាប់ដែលសហប្រញ្ញាយកមកសំអាងដើម្បីតាក់ទងជាមួយអ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE 38នឹងបានដាក់ជូនរបាយការណ៍របស់ខ្លួនដល់អង្គជំនួយរះនិងភិក្ខុនានាស្ដីពីវត្តមាននិងអនុសាសន៍នានាសម្រាប់ការកំណត់ពេលវេលានិងវិធីសាស្ត្រនៃការបង្ហាញខ្លួនរបស់គាត់យកឯកសារលេខ E 166/1 នៅក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការនីតិវិធីនៅអបតកវាជាគោលការណ៍មូលដ្ឋានដែលថាសាក្សីទាំងអស់ជាសាក្សីរបស់អង្គជំនុំជម្រះពុំមែនជាសាក្សីដែលកោះហៅដោយភាគីឬរបស់ភាគីណាមួយនៃកិច្ចដំណើរការនីតិវិធីទេតាមរយៈអនុសាសន៍ចុះថ្ងៃទី6ខែកុម្ភៈឆ្នាំ2012យោងឯកសារលេខ E166អង្គជំរះបានបញ្ជាក់ពីចេតនារបស់ខ្លួនក្នុងការកោះហៅអ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE38 នៅដំណាក់កាលសម្ណាការនិងបានបង្គាប់ឲ្យសហប្រតិញ្ញាតាក់ទងជាមួយអ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE38 ក្នុងគោលបំណងតិចតួចគឺសម្រាប់ពីវត្តមាននិងជួយដល់អង្គជំរះក្នុងការរៀបចំផែនការនិងកំណត់ការប្រឆាំងដល់សកម្មភាពតែប៉ុណ្ណោះក្នុងការបំពេញការងារដែលប្រកួតសិទ្ធដោយអង្គជំរះនោះសហប្រញ្ញាបានតាក់ទងជាមួយអ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE38 និងមានបញ្ចូលរាល់លិខិតតាក់ទងទាំងអស់ជាមួយអ្នកជំនាញរូបនេះនៅក្នុងសំណុំឯកសារជាមួយអង្គភាពគាំពារសាក្សីនិងអ្នកជំនាញទៅតាមការបង្គប់របស់អង្គជំរះរួចហើយដោយសារអ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE38 ជាសាក្សីរបស់អង្គជំរះបញ្ហាដែលនៅចំពោះមុខលោកលោកស្រីចក្រមនាថ្ងៃនេះគឺថាតើអង្គជំរះគួរតែអនុវត្តឆន្ទានុសិទ្ធិរបស់ខ្លួនដូចមានចែងក្នុងវិធាន26ចំណុច1នៃវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងដើម្បីអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យសាក្សីដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE38 ដល់សកម្មកម្មតាមរយៈសតទោះជំនួសឲ្យបានបង្ហាញខ្លួនដោយផ្ទាល់បានដែរឬយ៉ាងណានោះអនុញ្ញោមតាមបទបញ្ញត្តិនេះអង្គជំរះសាលាដំបងអាចអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យប្រើប្រាស់បច្ចេកវិទ្យាសតទោះក្នុងករណីដែលសាក្សីមិនអាចផ្ដល់សក្ខីកម្មដោយផ្ទាល់បានក្នុងការអនុវត្តឆន្ទានុសិទ្ធិនេះអង្គជំរះត្រូវធានាថាសតទោះអាចអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យសាក្សីផ្ដល់សក្ខីកម្មស្របពេលជាមួយគ្នានោះដោយអង្គជំរះក្តីនិងដោយភិក្ខុនានាក្តីហើយការប្រើប្រាស់សតទោះនឹងមិនត្រូវធ្វើឲ្យអន្តរាយធ្ងន់ធ្ងរឬមិនស្របទៅនឹងសិទ្ធិការពារខ្លួនរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតឡើយដូចភាគីទាំងអស់ដែលថាគឺសហប្រញ្ញាចង់ស្ដាប់សកម្មភាពពីអ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE38 ដែលផ្ទាល់ជាងការមិនផ្ទាល់ទោះជាយ៉ាងណាក្តីព័ត៌មានដែលទទួលបានពីអ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE38 និងដែលបានបញ្ចូលក្នុងសេចក្តីជូនដំណឹងជាលិខិតអក្សររបស់សហប្រញ្ញាចំពោះភាគីយោងតាមឯកសារ E166/1 បង្ហាញថាគាត់មានការមមាញឹកក្នុងអាជីពពុំអាចមានវត្តមានដល់ទាល់នាឆ្នាំនេះបានទេហេតុនេះសាប្រញ្ញាស្នើសុំឲ្យអ្នកជំនាញដែលមានហាសនាម TCE38 បញ្ជាក់ឲ្យបានច្បាស់ពីវិសាលភាពនៃភាពមមាញឹកក្នុងអាជីពការងាររបស់ខ្លួនគាត់បន្ទាប់ពីពន្យារពេលមួយរយៈអ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE38 បានផ្ដល់ព័ត៌មានពិស្ដារពីការស្រាវជ្រាវពីការបង្រៀននិងកិច្ចការងាររដ្ឋបាលដទៃទៀតហើយសាប្រញ្ញាបានដាក់ជូនឯកសារពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនេះទៅអង្គភាពគាំពារសាក្សីនិងអ្នកជំនាញតាមការបង្គាប់រួចរាល់អស់ហើយទំនងជាថាមានតែតាមរយៈសតទោះទេអាចជាមជ្ឈបាយងាយស្រួលតែមួយគត់សម្រាប់ស្ដាប់សកម្មភាពរបស់អ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE38 ក្នុងសម្ណាការដំណាក់កាលនេះហេតុនេះហើយបានជានៅក្នុងរបាយការណ៍ជាលិខិតអសររបស់ខ្លួនញើជូនអនជំរះនិងភិក្ខុនានាសាប្រញ្ញាជូនយោបល់ថាគួរប្រើមធ្យោបាយសតទោះវិញជាការប្រសើរជាងនៅក្នុងការពិចារណាថាតើគួរអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យអ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរហស្សនាម TCE38 មានវត្តមានតាមរយៈសតទោះឬយ៉ាងណានោះអង្គជំរះត្រូវវាតម្លៃថាតើវាសອບទៅនឹងធៀបផ្សំនានានៃវិធានទីក្នុងពលគឺវិធាន 26.1 ឬទេក្នុងនេះនាថ្ងៃនេះសាប្រញ្ញាសូមលើកឡើងនៅអំណាចណាងចំនួន3ជូនលោកលោកស្រីចក្រមដើម្បីជៀបដូចតទៅទី1យោងវិធាន 26.1 មិនបានដាក់បន្ទុកដល់សាប្រញ្ញាក្នុងការបង្ហាញថាសាក្សីណាម្នាក់មិនអាចផ្ដល់សក្ខីកម្មដោយផ្ទាល់បានទេទៅទៅវិញអង្គជំរះដែលជាស្ថាប័នតុលាការត្រូវកោះហៅសាក្សីនោះត្រូវធានាថាតើវាស្របទៅនឹងធៀបផ្សំនានានៃវិធានទីក្នុងវិធានលេខ 26.1 ឬទេទី2ការប្រើប្រាស់បច្ចេកវិទ្យាសតទោះនិងអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យសាកសួរសំណួរបន្តផ្ទាល់ឬសອບពេលជាមួយគ្នា ដល់សាកសួរដែលបានស្នើសុំដោយភាគីនិងដោយអង្គជំរះផ្ទាល់តែម្ដងចំណុចទី3ការប្រើប្រាស់បច្ចេកវិទ្យាសោទស្សន៍ពុំរំលោភសិទ្ធិជនជាប់ចោទផ្ទាល់តែសោះលោកសីចក្រមមុនពេលឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងអំណាចម្ដងទាំងអស់នេះខ្ញុំសូមធ្វើការសង្កេតបឋមខ្លះខ្លះទៅលើច្បាប់ជាធរមានពលគឺវិធាន 26.1 នៃវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងនិងវិធាននីតិវិធីនិងទម្លាប់អនុវត្តនៅក្នុងយុត្តាធិការនៃតុលាការព្រហ្មទណ្ឌអន្តរជាតិដល់ទីទៀតដោយអនុលោមតាមមាត្រា33នៃច្បាប់ស្ដីពីការបង្កើតអវតកការសង្កេតបឋមទៅលើច្បាប់ជាធរមានតទៅនឹងវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងនៃអវតកដោយលោកសិស្សចក្រមជាស្រាប់ហើយខ្ញុំបាទសូមជម្រាបនៅក្នុងសេចក្តីផ្នែកបដៅរីមកហើយថាគឺថាការប្រើប្រាស់បច្ចេកវិទ្យាសោទស្សន៍សម្រាប់គោលបំណងនៃការផ្ដល់សកម្មភាពនៅអវតកត្រូវបានកំណត់នៅក្នុងវិធាន 26.1 នៃវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងវិធាន 26.1 បានផ្ដល់ឆន្ទានុសិទ្ធិដល់អង្គការស្លាដំបងដើម្បីអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យប្រើប្រាស់បច្ចេកវិទ្យាវីដេអូដែលត្រូវឲ្យស្របទៅតាមភាពសមចំនួន3សំខាន់ដូចខាងក្រោមទី1សាកសួរនោះមិនអាចផ្ដល់សកម្មភាពដោយផ្ទាល់បានទី2សោទស្សន៍អាចឲ្យអង្គជំរះនិងភាគីសាកសួរសាកសួរបាននៅពេលដែលសាកសួរត្រូវផ្ដល់សកម្មនិយាយម្យ៉ាងទៀតគឺមានន័យថាការសាកសួរបន្តផ្ទាល់ឬស្របពេលជាមួយគ្នានិងទី3គឺការប្រើប្រាស់បច្ចេកវិទ្យាវីដេអូមិនមានអន្តរាយធ្ងន់ធ្ងរឬមិនផ្ទុយពីសិទ្ធិការពារខ្លួននៅក្នុងករណីនេះគឺសិទ្ធិរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនោះទេគួរជំហរនៅចំពោះមុខតុលាការព្រហ្មទណ្ឌអន្តរជាតិដទៃទៀតស្រដៀងគ្នានឹងអវតកដែរអង្គជំរះស្លាដំបងនៃតុលាការព្រហ្មទណ្ឌអន្តរជាតិដទៃទៀតមានឆន្ទានុសិទ្ធិក្នុងការអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យសាកសួរផ្ដោតសកម្មភាពតាមរយៈសោទស្សន៍បានសំណើសុំបែបនេះពុំមែនជារឿងចម្លែកនោះទេហើយដោយឡែកចំណែកឯតុលាការ ICTY គឺមានច្បាប់យុត្តិសាស្ត្រជាច្រើនដែរពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងបញ្ហានេះនៅក្នុងអំណាចអំណាងរបស់យើងខ្ញុំគួរជំហរដែរតុលាការទាំងនេះប្រកាន់យកនៅពេលឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងសំណើសុំប្រើប្រាស់សោទស្សន៍អាចជាជំនួយខ្លះដល់អង្គជំរះក្នុងការសម្រេចបញ្ហាដែលមាននៅចំពោះមុខលោកដូសីចក្រមនាថ្ងៃនេះអាស្រ័យហេតុនេះមុនពេលនិយាយពីធៀបសំសំខាន់សំខាន់នៅក្នុងអំណាចអំណាងរបស់យើងខ្ញុំប្រសិនបើលោកដូសីចក្រមអនុញ្ញាតនាពេលនេះខ្ញុំសូមធ្វើការពន្យល់ដោយសង្ខេបនៅវិធីសាស្ត្រដែលបានប្រើប្រាស់រួចមកហើយនៅឯតុលាការ ICTY ICTR និង ICC ចំពោះតុលាការមិនអចិន្ត្រៃយ៍តុលាការ ICTR និងតុលាការ ICTY អនុញ្ញាតឲ្យប្រើប្រាស់សកម្មភាពតាមរយៈសោទស្សន៍នៅពេលដែលសាក្សីមិនអាចឬមានហេតុផលសមរម្យដែលបង្ហាញថាខ្លួនមិនអាចផ្ដល់សកម្មដោយផ្ទាល់បាននិងសកម្មរបស់សាក្សីនោះពិតជាមានសារៈសំខាន់ដែលអាចនឹងបណ្ដាលឲ្យមានភាពអយុត្តិធម៌ដល់ភាគីដែលបានស្នើសុំប្រសិនបើអង្គជំនុំជម្រះដំណើរការដោយពុំមានសក្ខីកម្មរបស់សាក្សីរូបនោះទេភាគីដែលបានស្នើសុំប្រើប្រាស់បច្ចេកវិទ្យាវីដេអូត្រូវធានាជូនអង្គជំនុំជម្រះស្លាដំបងថាគឺត្រូវតែស្របទៅតាមធៀបផ្សំទាំងអស់នេះទុបីតុលាការមិនអចិន្ត្រៃយ៍ចំនួន2គឺតុលាការ ICTR និងតុលាការ ICTY ជាអ្នកបានបង្កើតលក្ខខណ្ឌស្រដៀងគ្នាសម្រាប់គោលបំណងនៃការសម្រេចថាតើសកម្មភាពតាមរយៈប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍អាចអនុញ្ញាតបានដែរឬទេឬក៏យ៉ាងណាក៏តុលាការទាំងពីរនេះបានប្រកាន់យកវិធីសាស្ត្រខុសគ្នាច្រើនក្នុងការប្រើប្រាស់សកម្មភាពតាមប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍ដែរសភាញ្ញាមិនឯកភាពទៅនឹងការលើកឡើងរបស់មេធាវីការពារជនជាប់ចោតអៀងសេរីនឹងចំពោះបញ្ហានេះឡើយហើយសូមអង្គជំរះសូមអង្គសំណាកាពិនិត្យមើលឯកសារយោង E166/1/1ត្រង់កថាខណ្ឌ19តុលាការ ICTR តែងតែធ្លាប់បានសម្រេចថាការប្រើប្រាស់បច្ចេកវិទ្យាវីដេអូគឺជាវិធានការពិសេសដែលអាចត្រូវបានអនុញ្ញាតនៅពេលមានហេតុផលត្រឹមត្រូវតាមច្បាប់លើកចំពោះអង្គជំរះដោយមានឯកសារសំអាងយ៉ាងត្រឹមត្រូវតាមរយៈការប្រៀបធៀបយើងឃើញថាក្នុងការទទួលស្គាល់អំពីតម្រូវការពន្យារកិច្ចដំណើរការនីតិវិធីចំនួនជំរះតុលាការ ICTY បានអនុវត្តវិធីសាស្ត្របត់បែនជាងនេះជាងបណ្ដាលក្ខខណ្ឌតម្រូវដើមដែលថាបច្ចេកវិទ្យាសោទស្សន៍នឹងត្រូវបានអនុញ្ញាតតែនៅក្នុងកលតិស័កពិសេសត្រូវបានបោះបង់ចោលវិធានថ្មីមួយត្រូវបានបង្កើតឡើងដែលអាស្រ័យទៅលើការបំពេញលក្ខខណ្ឌខាងលើអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យអង្គជំរះស្លាដំបង នុញ្ញាតឲ្យមានការប្រើប្រាស់សេរីកម្មតាមប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍នៅពេលណាហោប្រយោជន៍នៃយុត្តិធម៌តម្រូវឲ្យធ្វើយ៉ាងដូច្នេះជាចាំបាច់ជាងនេះទៅទៀតតុលាការ ICTY តុលាការ ICTY ក៏បានបញ្ជាក់អំពីតម្លៃជាភស្តុតាងនៃសេរីកម្មតាមប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍ហើយវិធានដើមដែលបានបង្កើតឡើងនៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងរដ្ឋអាជ្ញាទល់នឹងតាឌិចដែលមេធាវីការពារជនជាប់ចោតអៀងស្រីបានលើកត្រង់កថាខណ្ឌ20នៃអំណះអំណាងរបស់ខ្លួនយោងតាមឯកសារ E166/1/1ដែលបានចែងថាខ្វះតាងដែលផ្ដល់តាមរយៈប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍
ក្រុមប្រធានសូមអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យក្រុមវិញ្ញា slow down តិចទៀត
អូខេជាងនេះទៅទៀតតុលាការ ICTY ក៏បានបញ្ជាក់អំពីតម្លៃជាខ្វះតាងនៃសេចក្តីកម្មតាមប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍វិធានដើមដែលបានបង្កើតឡើងនៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងរដ្ឋអាជ្ញាទល់នឹងតាឌិចដែលមេធាវីការពារជនជាប់ចោតអៀងសេរីបានលើកឡើងត្រង់កថាខណ្ឌ20នៃអំណះអំណាងរបស់ខ្លួនយោងតាមឯកសារ E166/1/1ដែលបានចែងថាខ្វះតាងដែលផ្ដល់តាមរយៈប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍ពុំសូវមានទម្ងន់ដោយខ្វះតាងដែលផ្ដល់ផ្ទាល់នៅសវនកម្មឡើយជំហររបស់តុលាការ ICTY បានប្រែប្រួលគួរឲ្យកត់សម្គាល់ចាប់ពីពេលនោះមកនៅក្នុងច្បាប់យុទ្ធសាស្ត្ររបស់ខ្លួននាពេលទើបកន្លងផុតទៅថ្មីថ្មីនេះរួមទាំងសេចក្តីសម្រេចនៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងហាស៊ីហសានូវិចចាប់ពីឆ្នាំ2004និងនៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងលុចគិចពីឆ្នាំ2009តុលាការ ICTY បានរសារជំហរថាភស្តុតាងដែលផ្ដល់តាមប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍មានតម្លៃជាភស្តុតាងខ្ពស់ដូចភស្តុតាងដែលផ្ដល់ឲ្យដោយផ្ទាល់ដែរសូម្បីតែនៅមុនពេលសេចក្តីសម្រេចទាំងនេះចៅក្រមរីឆាតម៉ៃនិងចៅក្រមម៉ារីកាវីដាដែលជាអ្នកជំនាញច្បាប់ស្ដីពីភស្តុតាងនៅក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការនីតិវិធីប្រំពាត់អន្តរជាតិបានសង្កេតឃើញថានៅតុលាការ ICTY ឧស្សាហ៍មានសេចក្តីមានឧស្សាហ៍មានសេចក្តីកម្មតាមប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍ច្រើនគួរសមដែរចំពោះតុលាការប្រំពាត់អន្តរជាតិខ្ញុំសូមលើកឡើងដូចតទៅបើងាកមកតុលាការប្រំពាត់អន្តរជាតិបើយោងតាមមាត្រា69ចំណុច2នៃច្បាប់លក្ខន្តិកៈទីក្រុងរ៉ូមបានចែងថាទោះបីសក្តិស័ក្តិត្រូវផ្ដល់សេចក្តីកម្មដោយផ្ទាល់ក្តីក៏អង្គជំរះសាលាដំបូងអាចអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យមានការប្រើប្រាស់សេចក្តីកម្មតាមប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍ផងដែរបើអនុលោមតាមបញ្ញត្តិនៃលក្ខន្តិកៈនេះនិងវិធាននៃយុតិវិធីនិងភស្តុតាងក៏បានបញ្ជាក់យ៉ាងដូចនេះដែរយ៉ាងទៀតនៅក្នុងការអនុវត្តឆន្ទានុសិទ្ធិរបស់ខ្លួនអង្គជំរះសាលាដំបូងចាំបាច់ត្រឹមតែជឿជាក់ថាសិទ្ធិរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតក្នុងការសួរនេនដោលស័ក្តិសិទ្ធិដាក់បន្ទុកត្រូវបានគោរពនិងការប្រាស្រ័យសកម្មតាមប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍នឹងធ្វើឲ្យស័ក្តិសិទ្ធិមានលទ្ធភាពទទួលបានការសួរនេនដោលដោយភិក្ខីព្រះញ្ញាមេធាវីការពារក្តីនិងអង្គជំរះពលគឺនៅពេលដែលស័ក្តិសិទ្ធិប្រាស្រ័យកម្មយោងតាមវិធាន67នៃវិធាននីតិវិធីនិងភស្តុតាងរបស់តុលាការប្រំពាត់អន្តរជាតិលោកសរសៃចក្រមជាទីគោរពនៅចុងក្រោយនេះខ្ញុំសូមបង្ហាញជូននៅការយកឃើញជាចុងក្រោយថាការបង្កើតវិធាននៃតុលាការប្រំពាត់អន្តរជាតិគឺស្រដៀងគ្នាខ្លាំងទៅនឹងវិធាន 26/1 នៃវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងដែលសរបញ្ជាក់បន្ថែមទៀតអំពីទំនោរទៅរកវិធីសាស្ត្របត់បែននិងត្រូវបានកំណត់យកធ្វើជាគោលការណ៍ក្នុងការប្រើប្រាស់បច្ចេកវិទ្យាប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍នៅក្នុងតុលាការឧក្រិដ្ឋកម្មអន្តរជាតិនេះទីបញ្ចប់ខ្ញុំសូមឲ្យលោកលោកស្រីចក្រមមេត្តាពិនិត្យពិចារណាទៅលើវិធាន 26.2 នៃវិធានទីក្នុងទៅលើសេចក្តីការរបស់អ្នកជំនាញដែលមានរដ្ឋសនាម TC38 ព្រោះវិធាន 26.1 គឺវិធានដ៏មានសារៈសំខាន់បំផុតហើយអ្វីដែលខ្ញុំបានលើកឡើងនេះគឺជាការយកឃើញរបស់សពញ្ញាហើយសូមឲ្យអង្គជំនះមេត្តាពិនិត្យនិងពិចារណាទៅតាមគតិច្បាប់សូមអរគុណបាទសូមបញ្ចប់ការយល់ឃើញតម្លៃយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតែប៉ុណ្ណេះហើយសូមបញ្ចប់សូមអរគុណលោកប្រធាន
បញ្ហាទី2គឺជំទាស់ទៅនឹងសំណើសុំរបស់ក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីអៀងសេរីដែលស្នើសុំយកឯកសារបន្ថែមពីអ្នកជំនាញមុនពេលអ្នកជំនាញផ្ដល់ទៅខិច្ចកម្មតើខាងសហប្រញ្ញាមាន ត្រូវលើកឡើងបញ្ហានេះដែរឬទេ
Je vous remercie, Monsieur le Président. En fait, mon collègue a fini sa section. J'en venais à ma section, toujours sur la question de la vidéoconférence. Mais je crois qu'il est déjà midi, donc je m'en remets à votre décision concernant le temps où on pourra prendre cette pause. Mais j'annonce déjà que...
អញ្ញម្រិះបានជម្រាបហើយថាលោកមានពេល15នាទីគឺរហូតដល់ពីម៉ោង 12:15 នាទីក្នុងការបង្ហាញនេះដើម្បីអង្គជម្រះលេីពេលវេលាឲ្យបានចប់នៅរសៀលនេះ
Merci beaucoup. Je voulais juste préciser que nous ne serons pas du tout longs sur la réponse aux objections, non, à la demande, pardon, de la défense concernant les documents. Je vais terminer d'abord la partie concernant la vidéoconférence. Et comme nous avons un droit de réplique, il nous paraissait aussi plus logique d'entendre d'abord la défense concernant sa requête concernant les documents supplémentaires à fournir par le...témoin expert Ben Kiernan, et puis d'y répondre. Donc nous allons, dans un premier temps, jusqu'à 12:15 et probablement encore au début de l'après-midi, continuer à parler de cette question du témoignage par liaison vidéo. Selon nous, et je vais développer ce que nous avons déjà dit maintenant, les coprocureurs devant les CETC n'ont pas la charge de prouver qu'il est impossible pour un témoin ou un expert de comparaître en personne parce que nous ne sommes pas dans un système inspiré de la common law et nous ne sommes pas ce qu'on appellerait devant le TPI grec la partie requérante ou la partie demanderesse par rapport au recours à la vidéoconférence pour ce témoin expert de la Chambre. Nous apparaît plutôt qu'il appartient à la Chambre de considérer l'ensemble des informations qui sont à sa disposition, dont celles qui ont été fournies par les coprocureurs à la demande de la Chambre, afin d'exercer son pouvoir d'appréciation conformément à la règle 26.1. Dans l'exercice de votre pouvoir discrétionnaire, il vous appartient de considérer en premier lieu si l'audition de l'expert est possible en personne.La défense de Yeng Sari a trop largement interprété ce critère et prétend que ce serait les coprocureurs qui seraient obligés, par la règle 26.1, de démontrer qu'il est impossible d'entendre la déposition de l'expert Ben Kiernan en personne. C'est le paragraphe 16 de leur document E166-1-1.Nous nous opposons à cette interprétation, considérons que rien dans la règle 26.1 ne suggère que les coprocureurs auraient l'obligation de démontrer cette impossibilité. Nous l'avons déjà dit devant les tribunaux internationaux ad hoc, c'est la partie requérante qui souhaite utiliser le moyen de la vidéoconférence qui a la charge.De prouver que le témoin ou l'expert est dans l'impossibilité de comparaître ou qu'il a une ou des raisons valables de refuser de comparaître. Une telle charge ne peut être imposée aux coprocureurs. Ici, les coprocureurs ont simplement formulé des recommandations suivant les instructions directes de la Chambre quant aux modalités de l'audition de cet expert. À ce sujet, je voudrais tout de même mentionner une précision d'ordre sémantique, mais qui a toute son importance. Dans le mémorandum de la Chambre, E-172-5 du 2 mars 2012, tel qu'il a été corrigé en français, Il est dit au paragraphe 6 que la Chambre a été saisie d'une demande d'éco-procureur visant à ce que TCE 38 dépose devant la Chambre par liaison vidéo. En anglais, le mot utilisé est de request by the prosecutors. Alors, je ne veux pas paraître pointilleux ou vous manquer de respect, mais le terme de demande qui est utilisé ici par la Chambre ne nous apparaît pas refléter le mandat limité que la Chambre elle-même avait donné au co-procureur dans le mémorandum E166 du 6 février 2012, qui était, je le rappelle, d'adresser dans un délai de 3 semaines des recommandations concernant l'établissement du calendrier et les modalités d'audition de cette personne. Et pour ce faire, de nous autoriser à prendre contact avec cette personne à la seule fin de voir si elle était disponible et d'aider la Chambre à prévoir et établir le calendrier de son audition en tant que témoin expert. Nous pensons avoir respecté ce mandat intégralement en adressant effectivement des recommandations que nous avons intitulé avis à la Chambre et au parti concernant la comparution de cet expert. Et vous verrez que dans notre avis, E166-1, nous avons pris soin de ne pas formuler de requête ou de demande, mais bien à chaque paragraphe d'utiliser les mots de recommandation. Et cela a un sens parce que nous ne sommes pas la partie requérante et nous avons joué simplement un rôle que nous a confié la Chambre d'intermédiaire entre la Chambre et l'expert, un rôle de mandataire faisant rapport à la Chambre qui nous a mandatés et faisant rapport aussi au parti de la mission qui nous avait été confiée. Alors nous redisons, parce que c'est nécessaire, clairement que nous préférerions, tout comme la défense, les parties civiles et votre Chambre sans doute, que le professeur Ben Kiernan soit entendu en personne, plutôt que par le biais d'une liaison vidéo. Néanmoins, c'est la Chambre qui choisit au cours du procès les témoins et les experts qu'elle souhaite entendre afin de contribuer à la recherche de la manifestation de la vérité et selon les modalités qu'elle considère les plus appropriées. Les témoins et les experts ne sont pas rattachés au parti, mais à la Chambre. Ce ne sont pas les témoins et les experts des partis. Peu importe qui les a initialement proposés, ce sont ceux de la Chambre. Et c'est une différence fondamentale pour nous en termes de procédure et en termes de position dans laquelle nous nous sommes trouvés par rapport au contact à établir avec le professeur Ben Kiernan. Les CETC partagent cette caractéristique du fait que les experts et les témoins sont des experts et témoins de la Chambre avec la Cour permanente internationale, mais ne partagent pas cette caractéristique avec les tribunaux internationaux ad hoc. Par conséquent, la règle 26.1 n'impose pas au co-procureur la charge de démontrer qu'il est impossible au professeur Ben Kiernan de témoigner en personne. Comme nous l'avons dit, il appartient à la Chambre de déterminer si l'utilisation ou non du témoignage par liaison vidéo paraît justifiée selon sa propre appréciation des justifications apportées non pas par la partie accusatrice mais par le témoin expert quant à son impossibilité de comparaître en personne. Le professeur d'université de Yale, Ben Kiernan, a d'abord informé la Chambre par le biais de communication échangée avec les coprocureurs qui ont chaque fois été transmises à l'unité d'appui aux témoins et aux experts, que j'appellerai WISU, comme la Chambre l'avait exigé dans un souci de transparence. Il a d'abord informé la Chambre, donc, qu'en raison de ses obligations professionnelles, il lui était impossible de venir témoigner en personne au Cambodge en 2012, mais qu'il pourrait peut-être comparaître en 2013. Les coprocureurs ont alors insisté auprès de l'expert pour qu'il fournisse à la Chambre, par écrit, les raisons justifiant son impossibilité de venir témoigner en personne en 2012. Après un certain temps, il a effectivement fourni, bien après notre rapport à la Chambre du 27 février, une liste détaillée de ses fonctions, de ses obligations professionnelles à l'Université de Yale, ce qui a été communiqué à WSU. Nous ne voulions pas trahir le mandat qui nous avait été confié et donc il nous apparaît qu'il appartient à la Chambre et non pas au coprocureur de décider si elle souhaite donner lecture à cette audience de ces justifications complémentaires fournies par le professeur Ben Kiernan. Si c'était le cas, nous pourrions procéder à cette lecture ou un greffier pourrait le faire également. Monsieur Ben Kiernan a également notifié au coprocureur qu'il serait disponible pour déposer par vidéoconférence à la fin mars ou le début avril à la mi-avril. Par la suite, il a précisé qu'il serait aussi disponible au début du mois de mai 2012. Au vu des informations communiquées récemment par M. l'expert Ben Kiernan, en tout cas expert potentiel, ainsi que des échanges précédents avec Wissou, qu'il a eu lui-même avec Wissou, il revient à la Chambre d'examiner si la comparution en personne du professeur est toujours possible, et si oui, à quel moment. Cependant, l'usage de la vidéoconférence nous apparaît à ce stade l'unique moyen réaliste de garantir sa déposition dans un délai raisonnable. D'où nos recommandations formulées après que Wissou ait fait de vaines tentatives auprès de l'expert de s'assurer de sa disponibilité de comparaître en personne. Si on est pragmatique, la réalité est que malheureusement, il semble que ce soit la liaison vidéo ou rien à l'heure actuelle. En ce qui concerne cet expert, pour autant, bien sûr, que vous considériez que les conditions légales sont remplies. Je vais aborder un autre point, Monsieur le Président. Il est déjà midi 15. Est-ce que je continue ou vous voulez que je m'interrompe?
ហើយឥឡូវដល់ពេលម៉ោង កំណត់ដែលត្រូវសម្រាកហើយហើយលើសរហូតដល់ដល់ប្រាំនាទីឯណោះយើងមានយ៉ាងទៀតក៏បញ្ហាស៊ីឌីក៏អស់ហើយដែរអញ្ចឹងសម្ដានការនេះគឺផ្អាកត្រឹមនេះដើម្បីពិសារថ្ងៃត្រង់ហើយសម្ដានការនឹងបន្តធ្វើនៅរសៀលនេះចាប់ពីដើមពីម៉ោង 1:30 នាទីសូមជួយលោកមេធាវី
Just very briefly, Your Honor, because there may be some impression left by the trial chamber that the information that the prosecution has from the direct contact the agents has with Ben Kiernan that was turned over to the West Room was actually provided to the parties. We have never received any of it. On March 9th, not only do we file, make a submission, but also we send a letter to the senior legal officer requesting an order from the chambers to direct the prosecution to provide that. The prosecutor was copied. We have not received anything from the senior legal officer. So in effect, if I am to make credible submissions, because the word transparency was used, I should be entitled to have that information as to what exactly Ben Kiernan said as to why he cannot come for the year 2012 when he knew back in 2011 that he was being called as a witness. So during the lunch break, Your Honor, we would ask that you direct WSU to turn over that information to us so I can see and process that into my presentation this afternoon. I think it's only fair. It's called the equality of arms. I don't see how the prosecution is prejudiced. I can only suspect that there might have been an impression that WSU would have turned it over to us as well. But this information has not, I repeat, has not
Yes, I would like, just like to ask, on behalf of my client, permission to stay downstairs after the break and join the ceremony themselves. I have prepared the appropriate waivers, which I will hand over if requested.
ហើយក្រុមវិទ្យាការពីក្តីជំនួយចាប់ចោតប្រគល់មកឲ្យជំរះភ្លាមនៅលិខិតដែលបងសិទ្ធមិនចូលរួមផ្ទាល់នៅក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្ដែងការនៅក្នុងបន្ទប់សម្ដែងការនេះអង្គជំរះយល់ព្រមតាមសំណើសុំនេះហើយឲ្យក្រុមវិទ្យាការពីក្តីជំនួយចាប់ចោតប្រគល់មកឲ្យជំរះភ្លាមនៅលិខិតដែលបងសិទ្ធក្នុងការចូលរួមសម្ដែងការដោយផ្ទាល់ដោយមានចុះលិខិតខាងស្នាមឬផ្ដិតស្នាមរៀបដៃយ៉ាងជាក់ច្បាស់ពីជនជាប់ចោតផងហើយប្រកប